Hello, Danvers. Good evening, good afternoon, whenever it is. Welcome to our Topics of the Town News, and this is our special report that we're conducting to answer some of the questions that we've had from our residents. Welcome to our local broadcast. This will be a series of reports with experts in the government of Danvers. Special report is really a, residents have asked many questions. Who really runs our town government? What type of government do we have? When and how does the government work? How does an average resident get involved? Who really runs this town? And I think you'll hear from our experts today that there is a rhyme and reason to this whole government situation. The town has placed all this information on their website. The information is not readily available because it takes a lot to search through the website. Therefore, this presentation, and what I want to do is share my infamous Albert Einstein quote, because that quote really means a lot to me, at least. And I fear the day that technology will surpass our human interaction. The world will have a generation of idiots. And this is a reflection of what's going on with our residents and our community. They don't communicate. And what we wanted to do on this show is to give you an opportunity to hear from the people that are actually involved in our government and how they participate and what kind of actions they actually take. The agenda and opinions are solely by the topics of the town host, guests, and contributors and commentators. This series will be made up of three segments. Part one is what we're filming today, and it's the history of the town meeting and government and the current town meeting. Part two, which we already have taped, the Board of Selectmen and Town Manager. And part three, I'm sorry, part two has not been taped yet, but part three, school committee and the superintendent with the library trustees and the library director. That's becoming an important position. Quote of the current town moderator position, and I've selected this quote for various reasons, because the challenge of leadership is to be strong, but not rude, be kind, but not weak, be bold, but not a bully, be thoughtful and not lazy, be humble, but not timid, be proud, but not arrogant, have a humor about your daily, activities. So that really represents to me the town moderator position, and I am very encouraged to have you as the moderator, because this statement has made it very clear to how we operate our town. And Richard, you're also included in this thing because you've been involved in town meeting for how many years now?
1967, I think.
1967, I was just a kid in high school.
Yeah, great.
So, what we want to do is, we'll give Mr. Trask, Richard Trask, the historian, and what else do you call yourself?
Town archivist.
Town archivist, there you go. And he'll give us a history of the current, and then we'll go into Pat Frazier with the current town meeting. But what I want to do is I want to present a clip of the town seal, which really represents the entire story. The purest of all democracies, the strongest of all citadels of civil liberty, the town meeting. And that's what we're going to be talking about today, because we have the two experts that have been involved for many, many years. So what I'd like to do is segment one, presentation and discussion with Richard Trask. So could you give us a little history lesson? Because I think this whole show is intended to be a civics lesson for the town and the residents and the students if they want to watch it. Here you go, Dick.
Very good. Well, thank you. Pleasure to be here. I'm going to start out with a quote. This is from Thomas Jefferson, our third president, who in 1816 set about the townships of New England and their town meetings. The townships in New England have proved themselves the wisest invention ever devised by the wit of man for the perfect exercise of self-government and for its preservation. And when you just took a look at the town seal, the town seal was devised in town meeting in the 1890s. And I think it's one of the finest town seals in Massachusetts because it does show our town meeting. And it shows a town meeting in exercise. Of course, there weren't any women back then, only men could vote. And town meeting is quite peculiar to New England and a few other places throughout the United States. And the germination of town meeting probably dates back to Old England, not the parliament, not the legal system, but within the church system, in which church members and vestrymen would get together, and all of them who were church members would be able to vote for things having to do with the maintenance and integrity of the church. And the Puritans who came over to Massachusetts and New England in the early 1600s decided that this was a good way of making sure that everyone who should be participating could be. And of course, just like elections today in our governmental system, in those days it was much more restrictive than it is today. Initially, you had to be a church member. You also had to be a person who had enough money for a relatively small estate. So you had to own land. You also had to be a male. And also you had to be, early on it was 24 years. Eventually it got to be 21 years. Over time, this all changed, and Pat will talk a little bit about the changes that we made in the 20th century to make it more inclusive. But town meeting has been a very important aspect of local government in New England from the 17th century. Not to say there aren't any problems, and there are some problems. Some communities around us, such as Wenham and I think Hamilton, still have open town meetings in which anyone in the population can come and speak and vote. One of the problems with the old town meeting was the fact that if the population was more than, say, 1,500 or 2,000, it was very cumbersome to be able to have that many in a meeting. Also, the reality of people was that many town meetings, Danvers had a population of about 2,000 in the 1770s, and at many town meetings, you would get probably 30 or 40 people to come, and that was out of a population of people who could actually vote of about 400. So there are some problems incumbent in open town meetings, but the benefits far outweigh the problems. And let me just go into Danvers for a minute and where we came from. Danvers was settled in the 1630s and was a part of Salem Town. It became a parish, which meant they could have their own church, and they particularly wanted to become independent, especially as the population grew and as Salem's concerns were not the same with the mercantile people in Salem as they were with the farmers in Salem Village. So the villagers started petitioning from the 1670s on, and it wasn't until 1750s that Danvers came into being. And Danvers was originally composed of Salem Village and what then was known as the Middle Precinct, which is now Peabody. So Danvers and Peabody basically were the same community from the 1750s until the 1850s. And I'll show you something that's very precious. Hardly ever bring this out to show anyone, but this is basically our town birth certificate. It's a petition from Salem Village and the Middle Precinct to Salem Town to set up a town meeting to have the precinct and the village become an independent township. And it's signed by representatives of both the village and the Middle Precinct. It was finally allowed by the town of Salem and went through the legislature so that they finally decided that we would be able to have a community. However, we were not a township. In 1752, the legislature allowed Danvers, which was a name that they gave us, has no local relationship whatsoever, and it became a district. And a district is the absolute same as a town, except for one important thing, and that was that Danvers, the district of Danvers, could not elect and send a representative to our general court, to the House of Representatives. So we had no representation there. And the reason for that was King George II had edicted that Massachusetts could have no more townships because even in the 1750s they were giving problems to the crown. And they didn't want to have more legislators who would start doing things that they wanted to have done. However, Salem Town had two representatives. And in the 1750s, Salem would allow Danvers to have one representative representing Salem and Danvers, but it still wasn't right. It still wasn't a township. And in 1757, contrary to the local legislative laws, the legislature eventually made Danvers into a town. So that's why on the town seal we have 1757 as when Danvers became a town. Now, we didn't know it at the time, but about a year later, the Privy Council in England, in which the king was present, looked at the new bill creating the town of Danvers, and the king vetoed it. And they sent instructions that Danvers could not be a town, could not send a representative to the general court. And Danvers, if they even knew that happened, completely ignored it. And that's why on our town seal we have the phrase, the king unwilling.
Right.
And we continued to send representatives throughout. Town meeting today is not so much different than it was 200 years ago. The selectmen would edict a warrant in which they would specify a time and place and some items to be discussed at town meeting. They would be nailed to the church bulletin boards on the outside, and the day of the town meeting, people would show up. In those days, and up until, maybe about 20 years ago, our annual town meeting was in March. Right. And the reason for that was that Danversites were farmers. And the mud season began in March going into April, when you couldn't do much on the farm. You'd have to do repairs, but it was a little more time to be able to do important things other than at your own homestead. So March was the traditional date for town meeting. And there was another town meeting in May, in which the town members would send their votes for a representative to the general court. And we had a moderator. That was part of the function. And this little book, which I acquired a number of years ago, not specifically for Danvers, but for any town official in Massachusetts, it's called The Town Offices. And this particular issue dates to 1793. And it has the requirements of each office within the community, so people would know how they were supposed to work. And the moderator was a very important, always has been a very important office. And let me just read the little bit of it, and you see that things haven't changed that much. Although this is but an occasional officer, his office is honorable and important. Upon the due execution of it depends in a great measure the good order and decorum which ought to be observed in all town meetings. And Pat certainly does that at every meeting. I therefore judge it proper to infer his power and duties as follows. And then he lists what it is. So the moderator was always the person who was going to make sure that things went orderly and proper. The Board of Selectmen was an important position, but it was not a position in which they would be able to vote for any purchases or any activities that had to go through town meeting. And the selectmen, just like now, were also part of the town meeting. In those days, there were a lot of offices. We only have a few vestigial organs left in our town meeting, in which we appoint a fence viewer and a few other, which seem like very arcane positions. But back in the 17th century, the people wanted to make sure that they had a well-regulated township. So you would appoint a Hargreave. And a Hargreave was the person who was going to take care of the pigs. And every year, one of the most important votes locally was whether or not we'll let the pigs go wild or make them wear yokes so that they can't get through fences into neighbors' vegetable gardens and so forth.
Now we have chickens.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So those kind of things were important to have. But one of the things that they did back in those days that we don't do so much today is really comment upon what was happening provincially and within the country itself. And let me just list for you, at the beginning of the revolutionary period, we started having town meeting making votes that were very important to what would become the United States. And one of the most controversial things that ever happened at town meeting was in 1765. I won't give a whole history lesson, but that's when the Crown decided to have a Stamp Act, right, which was going to affect everybody. You get married, you have to have a tax. You buy a newspaper, you have to have a tax. And Americans hated it. And Danvers Town Meeting spent four pages of the minutes of the meeting instructing their representative to the general court how they should be against it. It was the most controversial thing that ever happened. 1770. May 28th, town meeting rules not to import, buy, or use tea until the tax shall be removed. 1773, late February, the town meeting votes that we will use all lawful endeavors for recovering, maintaining, and preserving the invaluable rights and privileges of this people, and stand ready, if need be, to risk our lives and fortunes in defense of those liberties which our forefathers purchased at so dear a rate. And then in 1776, we have town meeting in June, special town meeting, voting that if the Honorable Congress for the safety of the United Colonies declares themselves independent from the Kingdom of Great Britain, we, the inhabitants of Danvers, so do solemnly engage with our lives and fortunes to support them in that measure.
So even in the history of our town and our state and our United States, the town meeting has been a very important representation of the wishes and the responsibility of our residents.
Absolutely, yep.
And the only question I have, and I'll lead you on to that one, is how many town meeting members did they have at that time? Because I think we had three selectmen at that time, correct?
Well, over time, we've had seven, we've had five, and sometimes three.
So that varies,
yep,
in history. But town meeting members, how were they selected?
Well, you have...
Oh, this was all-inclusive. Everybody could go.
Not women.
No. Women certainly couldn't. Anyone who did not own property,
okay,
or paid for rental of property couldn't. And you had to be, by the 1770s, 21 years old. However, okay, town meeting was not as strict as it perhaps sometimes sounds. Women did attend. People who couldn't theoretically vote did come, and depending upon who the moderator was, they might be able to vote. So out of a population of, say, 2,000 in the 1760s, 1770s, you probably had, knock off half because of the women, knock off another quarter because of the younger people. And so you're probably talking about around 500 people or so who would be able to go.
Could attend, right.
And in Danvers, it was peculiar in that we had basically what should be two towns, Peabody and Danvers, all as one. So one year we would meet in the North Parish in Danvers, the next year we would meet in the South Parish, Peabody. And depending upon where they met, the people from that section of town would be stronger than the ones who had to go further. So selectmen on one year would probably be more of a majority from what's now Danvers, and the next year from what's Peabody.
So and the shared number of responsibilities.
Shared responsibilities, yep. Unfortunately, a lot of people, even in March, did not or could not come. So you will find on the occasion when there's an important vote and they actually record how many people voted, you might find 30, 50, 60 is a real good vote. So a lot of people then were as ignorant to want to come and do their civil authorities as sometimes happens today.
And then when we got into the 1930s and 40s, we came out with a charter at that time, and that really established what our current town government is, which is really, Jack, if you can put up the org chart, is the residents, the registered voters, are still, always have been in charge.
Yes.
And what we have is representative town meeting. That's a difference from the past to the current system, where we have, well, I'll let you talk about that, because in 1930s, the town charter was switched over to a representative.
And that was an important thing to do because if you have a large population, it's very hard to be able to get enough people to come to really do the town's business. The other flaw in all town meeting is that if somebody wants a new street or they want a new school district within the town, those people would come to the meeting. And you would have kind of whatever the thing was, you would have more people.
Selective
coming.
Government, yep. Government
let me,
action.
Just before I go, let me just show you one more item. This is our first town meeting record book. It was restored back in, boy, the 1970s. And let me just show you the first town meeting record.
I want to take a look at that, Richard, before we start tonight.
Minutes, yeah. Minutes of meetings.
Yep, and here it is here on this side. Let me see if I can get it right for the camera. Is the first legal meeting. And the town clerk, just like today, the town clerk sits next to the moderator who is standing and writes down all that's happening. And in those days, the selectmen were also the collector of taxes, the assessors. So much of the town meeting records gives what the tax is going to be for each person in.
Boy, I like to pay those taxes.
Yeah, I know.
Well, no, that's a transition. Basically, what you've expressed to us is a synopsis of what happened in the past is really continuing right now, maybe in slightly different forms. But the thing is that we no longer have open town meeting. We have different organizations. So, Pat, take it away.
Well, thanks so much for having me here tonight, Mark. Just a little commentary about the open town meeting versus representative town meeting. As Richard has indicated, we've had representative town meetings since the 1930s. I belong to the Massachusetts Moderators Association, and so in those meetings, you do get that combination of both folks like me who are involved in a representative town meeting and those folks who are who I think at some point struggle with the open town meeting for several reasons. As Richard's indicated, population, they end up having to have different rooms for town meeting members. They'll have a quorum at the beginning of the night. As Richard's indicated, people who are invested in one topic will come, will vote, and they'll leave, and they'll lose their quorum by the end of the night. You know, I think given in today's world, a representative town meeting actually works a lot better.
But you also have an opportunity as a resident, after the town meeting members discuss and debate the issues, a resident can be recognized and speak to the issue as well.
Absolutely. So once the elected town meeting members have an opportunity to ask questions, to make comment, to debate, a town resident, they don't sit within the town meeting body. They sit at the back of the room. But once they, once the formal debate has concluded, they are very free to participate. I think that, there's not too many that take advantage of that scenario, but it is certainly available. The other difference, as Richard has indicated, there, in going through town meeting currently is also regulated by state statute, requires us to meet, if you're a town form of government with a town meeting, we're required to meet once a year, to vote on an annual budget and take up other business that may be important to the town. Richard's talked about the warrant, the importance of the warrant. That is under state law the exact same today. The select board They set the agenda by publishing the warrant. We only vote and consider those items that are on the warrant and have been published. So there's no new business. There's no, really opportunity for somebody to raise their hand and say, well, I think we should be voting on this tonight. The agenda, the time, and the place, and the date is all set by the board of the select board. And so that has not changed. So I thought it was interesting when Richard was talking about some of the historic votes that had taken place, particularly in the 1700s leading up to the Revolutionary War. And you think of town meeting as being these rabble rouses, but in effect, those were part, for them to have taken a vote, it was a warrant. So that was the agenda, those were the proposals initially published and discussed by the select board for the town.
Well, the town meeting itself, the 144 town meeting members that we have, are basically the legislative body of the town, and they hold the purse strings and they authorize any action that are being proposed.
It is in essence a legislative body, but unlike legislatures that we may think about, such as our state legislature or Congress, the town meeting does not, they don't hold hearings, they don't propose bills, what we vote on is essentially that agenda, again, is set by the Board of Selectmen.
Right.
Or the Select Board.
So it's, well, you're using the right terminology, the Select Board. I call them the Selectmen.
I keep on that historically, and I sat on a board that was called
I know,
Board
we
of
sat
Selectmen.
Next to each other at one time. But the thing is that the town meeting is so important.
Absolutely.
That people really in the general public don't realize that they have the full responsibility of what goes on in the town. Even if the Board of Selectmen, Select Board, may propose things, the town meeting can say no.
Exactly. And I think it's important to note that the town meeting votes on all appropriations. They vote on borrowing. They vote on acquisition or disposition of land.
Land, right.
And so it really all and for most and for significant bylaw changes, there's a chunk that just the privy of the select board, but for the vast majority of bylaws and regulations, those are also the subject and under the purview of the town meeting.
And the one thing that I like to stress, Jack, if you can put up the org chart again, the voters are the key to this organization, whether it's the Board of Selectmen, the school committee, and the library trustees. Those are the four elected positions that people can get involved.
Most certainly. And so, but also the town moderator. The town moderator position is only elected annually. It is the only position that is required to be elected annually. And I, maybe Richard can talk a little bit about the historic perspective, but I've always believed that to be true because it is so important for the moderator to just be even-handed, to be middle of the road, et cetera. And so that if you have a town moderator who is, I think, abusing that privilege of running the meeting, then by the time the next annual town meeting comes up, the voters can certainly dispose of somebody that they don't like or trust.
Well, see, there you go back to my original statement. The challenge of leadership is to be strong, but not rude. Be kind, but not weak. Be bold, but not bully. Be thoughtful, but not lazy. Be humble, but not timid. Be proud, but not arrogant, have humor, but without falling.
And I hope I live up to that quote, Mark, because it just, I've always viewed the moderator as giving all sides of an issue a reasonable opportunity to be heard. Right. If you raise your hand, you're not guaranteed to be called on to speak, but I like to try to, and that's the way I like to run the meeting. If there are discussions across the precincts, and I try to get to everybody and then come back again, because I just think that's so important to have just that wide variety of opinion expressed in a public meeting in a way that is not personalized. It's a way that is civilized.
Nothing personal.
Respectful. Right. And I try to lead with humility in that. I often will misspeak. I'll make fun of myself at some points.
Sometimes we make fun of you.
Well, that's right. Or I'll hear some
noise. But you have to have humor in doing
it. You have to have humor in doing it. And I think, to me, the big thing is we are all neighbors. And so that, to me, is an important factor, that nobody should be frightened of getting up and asking a question or participating in the debate. I speak for my living. I make my living by public speaking as an attorney. And I recognize that a lot of people feel very uncomfortable in that venue.
That's
and
right.
I work very hard, particularly in advance of the town meeting, with town meeting schools, so that everybody understands how the meeting is going to go, the rules of the road, and to encourage folks to really get up and speak.
Right.
Now, it's interesting because, as you indicated, there's 144 members who are elected across 8 precincts, 18 to a precinct. That changes, as you know. It changes every 10 years due to the census and recalculation of the population and where the population is within the town, growth within the town. And then you have the 5 members of the select board, also members of town meeting. And unlike olden days, they get to vote on what they've proposed. And so you do have that.
Now, I just want to remind everyone is that you have produced or you have assisted in producing this town meeting handbook, which is basically the result of a lot of study of the town charter, the Town Manager Act, and you as a town moderator. What qualifications does anybody need?
To be town moderator?
To be town moderator or town meeting member.
No. So I think for any elected position, there are no qualifications to get on the ballot, with the exception of the requisite number of signatures that one has to produce
and
on
a
nomination
and
a resident. You don't have to be a taxpayer. You can be a renter to hold any position in town. All you have to do is be a resident. For town meeting members, I just really encourage that if folks are interested in really, frankly, having a seat at the table. That's how I began my involvement. I had a young child who would be entering the school system, and I really wanted a seat at the table when all types of decisions were being discussed.
Right.
So I think town meeting is an excellent way to initially get involved. It's a pretty limited time commitment. You get exposed to all areas of government. Unlike when I think the 3 of us started out in office, the various offices we've held, now everything is on either TV or YouTube channel. So you don't have to go to the Finance Committee meetings. You don't have to go to the Select Board meetings. You can actually view and obtain information without leaving your home.
Well, you're going to contradict my Albert Einstein you know, quote.
Oh, no,
because
no, no.
the personal interface at the town meeting or at the finance committee meeting, that's another role that you have. You appoint the town finance committee.
But I'm in trying to make the argument and encourage folks to be interested in town meeting and running for town meeting seats. You try to make it as easy as possible for people to listen and say, hey, I could do that.
Right.
Hey, I could make that time commitment. I personally think it's so much more preferable to be in person at these meetings, but with the understanding that in today's busy world, you really don't, oftentimes you don't have the opportunity to do that.
Well, the thing that I think people have to understand, and Richard, if you can help me here, is that the town meeting itself is really responsible for addressing all the proposals or the spending that's happening, and they have their own precincts that they are representing at the town meeting. And certain things happen in one precinct and not in others, but they all have that responsibility to move forward in town business.
Right.
The town meeting does not make day-to-day decisions. Even the Board of Selectmen don't make those day-to-day decisions because they have delegated their authority to a manager, whether it's the school department, the superintendent, or the Board of Selectmen delegates their authority and responsibility to the town manager, and the library trustees delegate their responsibility and authority to the library director. So there are levels of management. Town meeting is so important, and people really don't get it yet. And
right.
That's why we want to make sure that history has proven to us that we are all together in this, whether there are 6,000 of us or 28,000. We have 28,000 population in this
right.
town. And that is a responsibility that the town meetings have to carry. So conclusion. I don't know what we can add to this, but Richard, your exposure to town meeting, you've been on there since 67, 68. I've been on town meeting, I don't know, but I was on the finance committee that was appointed at that time. That's an important position. And I was there for 10 years. And it's a opportunity to really get involved into nuts and bolts of what's going on with the budget. And that's why I know too much about the budget, so that they don't like me for that. So in conclusion, do you see much difference from the historic perspective to the current perspective of what is going on with our government? I mean, at that level, at the town meeting level.
If you look from the beginning down till now, much of how we governed ourselves then is similar to what we do now. With new technology, huge populations, new problems that we wouldn't have even thought about 100 years ago. We have a town manager, which we didn't have, and that's been the case since 1949.
Right.
We had a representative town meeting, which came in 1930, which made town meetings back in the 1880s and 1890s used to go for 4 or 5 nights. And there would be huge fights and so forth. The other difference between town meeting today and then is that at the annual town meeting, in the early days, we actually did all of the voting. First vote was for the town moderator for that particular meeting. and then it would be for the Board of Selectmen and for the 40 or 50 other positions that were required. And that's one thing that kept a number of people coming to town meeting, because if you weren't there, it was easy to say, well, John Smith, let's make him collector of taxes. And you didn't want to be, or a constable, and you didn't want to be that. So you often would be there to say, well, I'm sorry, but I can't do that. We mentioned earlier how I always say the selectmen, because that's how it was pronounced back in the old days. Now it's the board.
Select board.
Yeah, select board. They make up the warrant for things that they realize are important for the community and for the functioning of the town. But here's an example. We still have it today. Citizen petitions. This is a citizen petition in 1776 signed by 8 or 9 important citizens at the time. And in this particular case, it was for establishing a Minuteman unit in Danvers for ready response. And that was always important. It made it so that town meeting was a functioning evolutionary organization that was able to take care of what the major concerns were for people at that time.
See, right now we have very similar type of a system for citizens' petitions.
And that's legislatively. That's
right.
Not a town that is under Massachusetts general laws, the ability to for citizens to petition to a town meeting. So that remains unchanged.
And that has been active in our town, and
absolutely,
we've experienced
yeah.
that in
absolutely,
our existence
yeah.
here. The thing is that citizens' petitions, I think at annual town meeting, all it takes is 10 signatures. And for a special town meeting or a special petition, it takes, 100,
yeah,
I think.
Right.
100 signatures. Usually you get more than that, but you can request anything you want. And the thing is, the town meeting may say, forget it.
Right.
We don't want you to into. They have to consider it, but they don't have to vote it in or out.
Right. So, you know, again, to that citizen petition, aspect, citizen petition is filed with the town clerk, who certifies the number of signatures. It is actually placed by the select board on the warrant.
Right.
That's the current process. So it's contained in a warrant. It's not something that's got sent out to the town meeting members. It is made part of a warrant, either for a special town meeting or part of the annual town meeting warrant. I think the select board, you know, as part of the warrant hearing, will discuss the citizen petition. Citizen petition is, again, because it's part of the warrant, part of the purview of the Finance Committee, will be discussed by the Finance Committee. They'll vote a recommendation, and that recommendation becomes a main motion, as you know, at town meeting.
And your involvement with the Finance Committee, you're the appointing authority.
I'm the appointing authority. I'm the appointing authority, actually, for two entities. One is the Finance Committee. The other is for the town's representative to the Essex Tech Board. And then again, oftentimes the moderator is requested or in charge with selecting people to join a committee that may have a special function.
Right.
So for an example, right now, there's as a result of action taken at the annual town meeting in May, there is a committee that I reached out to folks, and we formed to provide a town meeting and the select board guidance on future historic districts, et cetera.
Historic preservation district,
and
yeah.
districts, yeah. So, but you know, I've just found this fascinating. You know, I've always frankly cherished the position, holding the position of town moderator, truly. And after listening to Richard's description from probably like the first known town meeting time book, I'm even more, I feel even more just humbled and
I think you position. Have that book on reservation with, with Richard, and you
in.
Have to visit him because that is also the history behind this is very interesting. People don't understand it, and they don't want to learn. That's why we want to get this thing out to the general public. So what we're going to do now is I like to give both of you, I think I've covered most of the items. Denver's voters are in charge, basically. That's what they elect the town meeting members, they elect the moderator, and they elect the Board of Selectmen, the school committee, and the library trustees. That's a town-wide vote.
Exactly, and I think it's important to note, and you showed that on your org chart, that the select board, they hire the town manager.
Right.
So theoretically, you would the folks that get voted into that select board are chosen by the voters,
right.
And they select. Same with the library director, same with the superintendent, that, you know, I would argue that indirectly the voter is choosing those managerial positions by the
election of the boards.
By the election of the boards, absolutely.
Right. Town meeting is the legislative body elected by precinct, and we have 18 per precinct, 144 altogether, plus the five voters from the select board. And then who, when, and how elected or appointed, I think we've explained that pretty much. You've had that in your history side, and you have your current side. And we are all of us are subject to Mass General Laws and Town Charter, because every one of these positions is identified in the town charter or the town manager act. It's one and the same thing. And the general laws are the ones that are governing us through the, what do we have at the time, colonial days, we had the
General Court.
General Court. And now they still call themselves General Court.
Yeah.
So it's the legislative part of legal side. Town meeting handbook. You have been a contributor to this, and I remember that coming out back when we were on the board.
Well, so, and I will say that this, the town meeting handbook was last updated in 2002, which was an important anniversary within the town. And so it was published in celebration of that, and working closely with the town clerk at that time, an assistant town clerk. I came in on the tail end, so I provided their editorial assistance
there you
at
go.
The end.
The legal legalese. The Town Manager Act is a strong Town Manager Act, but I call it the weak Board of Selectmen, because they do not give the town manager day-to-day responsibilities. They provide them the policies that they want to be followed. And one thing that the Town Manager Act provides is politics are aside from his role, except through the Board of Selectmen, and they have the ultimate responsibility of what the town management does in this town.
And I think that's fair to say. I think the way to really look at it, and you and I both served on the board, Mark, at the same time, and I think the way to look at it is the select board is the they set the policy that the manager then executes.
Correct. So, in conclusion, what I like to do is give Mr. Trask, Richard Trask, an opportunity to closing comments. What do you think? Is this something worthwhile for our general public to be familiar with?
Absolutely. We get the government we deserve, which if people aren't informed, don't want to know what's going on, we'll get bad government. And nowadays, more so than ever, we have to be vigilant to make sure that the Constitution of the United States is adhered to, that our civil authorities continue to do what's best for the people,
yep,
guided by the Constitution. And those people who kind of are on the sidelines should really, if they are interested, they should bite the bullet and get involved.
Step in, right?
Yep, in local, state, and federal politics. It's very important.
Mrs. Frazier,
so
how about you?
And so I would totally agree with Richard on that. You know, I think it's so easy for folks to sit on a fence and throw rocks at what's happening. It's a lot different and a lot harder to get off the fence and be involved and not just be a bystander offering oftentimes negative commentary. I really encourage people to get involved and to be heard. There are so many opportunities within municipal government to be heard. And we've alluded to those. You know, all of these, the select board, the school committee, the library trustees, they are all subject to the open meeting law. And so they have open meetings. Citizens can come and listen. And again, listen and be heard at those meetings.
Right. So that's an opportunity for all our residents to get involved. But Jack, if you can just throw up my Tasmanian devil, and that's what I wanted to express to everyone is, I miss the good old days. Remember when you could actually have an opinion without offending somebody. And I think this is so appropriate to get this out on the air, and I'm going to issue these programs in a series, one through, because this is the most important one right now, because that sort of encompasses the entire town government, which is the people. And that's what we need to get across. So I appreciate your time. Thank you very much, Mr. Trask, and thank you very much, Mrs. Frazier.
Thanks so much for having me, Mark. I enjoyed it.
Well, I hope to get you back again, because this is an opportunity to educate our public. So thank you very much. Good night, Danvers. Thank you.